Welcome to Fraud Talk, the ACFE's monthly podcast. This is Mandy Moody, the ACFE social media specialist. And today I will be interviewing Jeff Windham. He is a JD and CFE and analyst at Forensic Strategic Solutions in Birmingham, Alabama. And he recently presented on the topic of the top 10 fraud examination legal pitfalls. So welcome, Jeff.
Thank you, Mandy.
And we're, you know, this is kind of a hot topic for us because we always see these, one of these top 10s or a few of these top 10s in an article, but really we don't ever get them together and break them down all together. So I think this will be good for our listeners to hear kind of everything in one podcast and things that they kind of face every day or face over a period of months when they're working on a case.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I put together these top 10 based on input from other CFEs that I've spoken to and based on examinations that we've done here in our office. So it's good to have them all together, and it's a good refresher and reminder on what those legal issues are that you may run into.
Yep. Wonderful. Okay, well, we will start with number 10, which is admissibility challenges. Tell us a little more about Rule 702 and how that applies and the challenges that may arise.
Rule 702 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure is referred to in general as the Daubert Rule and the Daubert Challenge. Daubert instructs the judge that any expert that's going to testify in a matter has to qualify who testify as an expert. They have to qualify by virtue of their knowledge, their skill, their experience, their training, or their education. And that or is very important. You could have four of the five of those things. You could have one of the five of those things, and you may still be an expert. The second ones are a little more simple, and that is that the expert's specialized knowledge will help the jury. Third is that the expert's opinions are based on sufficient facts and data. And fourth is a reliability test. And there's two prongs to that, and that's whether the expert has used reliable principles and methods and whether they have applied those principles and methods reliably.
Number nine, searches. And this is actually something that I think, you know, you go into that gray area. Tell us about workplace searches and what examiners need to keep in mind when they're doing searches.
It's a sticky area. The Fourth Amendment to the Constitution prohibits a government employer from making unreasonable searches in areas that a reasonable employee would expect to be free from a search. That would include things like a female's purse. That also might be something like a male's wallet. These are things that are personal. There is a control test for workplace searches, and that is whether or not the area being searched or the thing being searched is under the exclusive control of the employee, or is it under the exclusive control of the employer? The female's purse is a great example. Unless in a very rare situation your firm or office or company buys purses for you.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be nice?
It would be nice, I'm sure. But unless that happens, assuming you have purchased your own purse, that purse is yours, and that purse is off limits to being searched as long as it's not wide open sitting on a table. Then somebody could peer into it. But they couldn't search it because that's yours. That's totally under your control. The important thing to remember about the searches is the control test. If it's under the control of the employee, if it's something that's personal to them, then it's typically off limits. If it's something that is owned by or purchased by the employer, then it's typically okay to be searched.
So the next two, number eight, number seven. Number eight, employee rights, and number seven, invasion of privacy. Kind of tell me a little bit more about the rights that employees have coming into it and what to keep in mind. And then, you know, you can kind of bridge that with their expectation of privacy.
Sure. Yeah. And these are really important because in large companies, CFEs and risk managers and internal audit people, we have to talk to other employees and we have to do investigations and interviews at times. But we need to keep in the back of our heads that employees do have some constitutional rights. The most important are the Fourth, Fifth, and Sixth Amendments. As a CFE, if we're investigating or interviewing someone, and all of a sudden, just to give an example, it comes up that this person gets extremely nervous, starts to slow down, doesn't want to talk about anything else, and if we're talking about the Sixth Amendment, they may ask for their attorney before they speak anymore. They have the right to stop speaking, and they have the right to get that attorney. That translates into what I've listed as the number seven legal pitfall for fraud examiners, which is invasion of privacy. And invasion of privacy comes in two different flavors. The first is called publicity of private facts. An example of this would be if someone, let's just call him John Doe, climbs up to the top of the ACFE headquarters building with a handheld microphone and decides to shout out that Jim Smith has some kind of incurable disease. You know, you can fill in the blank. The second form of invasion of privacy is intrusion upon seclusion. And that happens when someone pries into the private matters of another person without a legitimate interest.
So number six, malicious prosecution and abuse of power. Give me kind of the lowdown on that and maybe what that might look like.
Yeah, this pops up when an examination usually has been completed. The elements for that are that there was an investigation or there was a proceeding, such as a criminal action, that occurred without just cause. Number two, with malice, which is an intent to harm the victim. And then number three, that the proceeding ends favorably to the victim.
But number five, financial privacy. In your presentation, you mentioned this. Several states have different legislation about this. What is something that examiners need to remember when looking into financial records?
This is one of my favorite ones to talk about. The key is in the law called the Right to Financial Privacy Act of 1978. There's all kinds of material about this out there. You can Google it. You can read it. It's very interesting. But the substance of it is, and what you need to take away from it, is that it prohibits a financial institution, which would include banks, investment firms, those type of entities, from releasing financial records of a customer to a government authority unless the government authority has demonstrated its compliance with procedures regarding confidentiality that are dictated by the statute. We just need to remember that because so many of our investigations and examinations involve financial aspects. We need to remember that we can't just go to a bank or a financial institution and get records on other individuals without going through all of the requirements in the Right to Privacy Act of 1978. And I'll tell you that generally what it comes down to is we oftentimes have to wind up either getting the consent from the person whose financial records you're looking for. That's the easiest way to go. Or number two, getting a warrant.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the things to remember about the Right to Financial Privacy Act.
And then number four, duress. I don't know how often this happens, but some examiners, I would imagine, do, you know, investigators, detectives, things like that might experience this more than others. But, you know, kind of speak about how that might play out.
Yeah, Mandy, duress always brings back in my mind thoughts of movies you may have seen with detectives or the police, where they've got a witness in an investigation room, and you know, they lay the witness down on the floor and put the chair over his neck and sit on it and start asking him questions and demanding that he answer, or he can't get up. And you know, while that makes for great entertainment in the movies and on TV, that's duress. And when a person is under duress, it's defined as a situation where a person is under the threat of violence or other pressure. Now, it can be as simple as just grabbing someone's shoulder and maybe giving it a little squeeze. So we typically, you know, don't want to touch people we're interviewing anyway, but we have to be really careful about that. It can be anything that is offensive or makes somebody feel threatened. It's often claimed by people after the fact, when they're presenting a defense to or challenging the validity of statements that they made. So, for example, if I'm interviewing you and we are in a room and I lock the door and I start slamming my fist down on the table and demanding that you answer my questions and, you know, threatening you with force, then I have now put you under duress because you are in fear. And even if you do answer my questions, then later on, let's say you give me a statement, later on you're going to be able to say, you know, I was not thinking right at that time. My statements are not valid. They're not good because I was under duress.
So number three, privileges and work product protection. You know, I think there might be some assumptions that people make about what might be privileged and what might not be. Kind of tell us what those distinctions are.
Yeah, and I address this in two ways. One is the attorney-client privilege as it relates to large companies, or it can be small and medium-sized companies too, but we generally think of large companies. And then I also like to talk about it in terms of CFEs who are doing private investigative work and maybe hired by attorneys or maybe hired by any third party. So let me talk first about the way it plays out in companies. And I'm thinking in terms of a large company, but again, a medium or small size company, this would apply to. And that is that business communications within the company, within communications from someone in the company to in-house counsel or maybe outside counsel, but usually you see it in regards to in-house counsel. Communications made by employees to the company's legal counsel are going to be privileged. The second part is, as CFEs, when we are working for attorneys in doing investigations, then we want to be sure to explain clearly what our role is. And one way that our firm does this is through a clause in our engagement letter that says, we agree to begin work on this matter as your consultants, and we anticipate that the work we do may be protected by the attorney-client, work product, or other applicable privileges. And what that does is that just sets an agreement between you and the engaging attorney that we're working as a consultant and our work for you is protected by the attorney-client privilege. And then if someone wants to challenge the work that we've done as a CFE for an attorney, then they may have to go try and go through the attorney-client privilege, which is not easy to do.
And number two, this kind of goes back to the interview room, but false imprisonment. You give some tips, you know, in part of the presentation, but kind of tell me what that is. And then those tips that you mentioned, you know, allow witness to sit close to the door, don't lock the door. Kind of tell me more about those.
Sure. False imprisonment is defined as the unlawful detention of a person by another for any length of time whereby he, she is deprived of his, her personal liberty. This is, like you said, locking someone in an interview room. We don't ever want to do that. We want to put the person as close to the door as we can. What I will do is, before I interview another person, I will actually arrange the chair so that their chair is between me and the door. That makes them closest to the door. That way, if anything comes up, if an issue comes up later, they won't be able to say, yes, he was blocking my exit, okay? And then I always recommend to, and this is our firm policy, as a matter of fact, we always have two interviewers so that if any issue comes up, that we have two people there that can verify or testify as to what happens.
And the number one fraud examination legal pitfall, defamation. You mentioned, you know, the definition of this, and then there's another case that you bring up, Lewis versus Rich. Tell us a little more about that, and then things that fraud examiners need to remember about defamation.
This comes up all the time. We've had cases on this, and I'll tell you about the case that we were involved in just a minute. But let me tell you just generally what the definition is of defamation. And it is that there's an untrue statement of fact published to third parties on an unprivileged occasion, and it's damaging to the subject's reputation. The Lewis versus Rich case that you mentioned, this is a great example of it. Actually happened here in my home state of Alabama in 1982. The facts of the case, Lewis called Rich a thief in the presence of another person. He stated that Rich had stolen money out of his wife's wallet. So Rich says, no, I didn't. That's wrong. You're lying. Other people had heard this, like I said, in the presence of other people. So Rich sues Lewis for slander, and he gets a jury verdict for $10,000. And $1982, you know, that's a decent amount of money. And it was affirmed. Lewis was unable to defend that statement that he made. Now, one of the defenses to defamation, and this is very important to remember, is that it's true. So if Lewis had called Rich a thief and it was true, Rich had stolen money out of Lewis's wife's wallet or pocketbook, then he would have had a defense and the verdict would have gone the other way. He would not have been liable. So truth is always a defense to defamation. Defamation is probably the biggest concern that we face as fraud examiners, and that's why I put it as my number one legal pitfall for fraud examiners.
Awesome. These are some really great tips. Well, thank you very much, Jeff. And we will post all of these 10 together up on our website for everyone listening to check out. But thank you very much for your time.
You are very welcome, Mandy. Thank you.
This has been another episode of Fraud Talk, the ACFE's monthly podcast. This is Mandy Moody signing off. Until next month.